tell me something that is truly random?
Ooh.
I mean, worth it just for that.
Just for that. Yeah. Elections, unless you're in Central Africa.
Oh. Or Russia or the United States.
Or United States.
I mean, I think, you know, it's a pretty general thing now.
Exactly.
I like to think Africa led the way.
We led the way. We inspired you.
Yes.
Now everybody's the biggest.
Yes. Oh. So.
If you put your finger in your ear and scratch,
yeah,
you get the sound from Pac-Man.
What?
Do you?
At this moment, 705 people are doing this.
That is absolutely right. I can hear it.
Yeah. I'm glad to have it confirmed by musical maestro Bill Baker.
No, it is absolutely... No, I can confirm that is musically correct. That's presumably how they came up with the sound in the first place.
Yeah.
Somebody bored at the gamer going, oh, hang on a minute, I've gone to something here.
That's fantastic. Extra point for Sally there. But the question is really about random playlists. So, you know, for example, on Spotify, you can have shuffle or random, can't you? So the thing is that people thought that the random function didn't shuffle the songs randomly enough. And it turns out the system was entirely random, but we can't process that because our brains look for patterns. And so what happens is if we hear a song three times in a row, which could happen if the song list was entirely random, we feel that some are being played more than others, some are being ignored, some possibly being blacklisted. And so they had to change the algorithm to make it seem more
random
than it actually was.
I just thought of something that's random, and that's birdsong.
Is that entirely random?
It's stochastic.
OK.
And what... You see, that's just the sort of attitude which we've tried to stamp out on this show. Get you with your knowledge.
No, I think he's being stochastic.
No, I'm being stochastic.
Third song, it was stochastic.
Yes!
Oh, that was a curlew, being sarcastic.
Yeah, that's it.
Not sarcastic.
No.
Anyway, I forgot what I was going to say now. Oh, yeah.
Bird stochastic.
Something amazing from Stoke.
Stoke, yes. That is stochastic.
Presumably, darling, they
not
have a
Robbie
set,
Williams.
Set
what?
Number of sounds that they can make.
No, the thing is that it's one of the reasons why birdsong is so relaxing, because it's slightly random. It's like if we listen to repetitive beats, eventually it gets on your nerves, or a drill or something. It's just exactly the same every time. Da, 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 da. But birdsong, it varies ever so slightly, just slightly enough, so that we love it. My favourite bird, obviously, is the great tit. Not just for the...
I mean, I'm with you, Bill.
Not just for the reasons, those base reasons.
I like the cock.
I know the cock, yes. The cock, the big... The... How have we gone down the road of innuendo so soon? So soon in the great...
All the birds in the world and it's the great pit.
Listen, it imitates the alarm calls of other birds, right? It's brilliant. So when it goes to the feeder on your, in your garden, it goes and does the alarm call, and all the birds go, oh, and they all leg it, and the great goes, ha ha, and just eats all the food.
I want a bird on my feeder that goes, ha ha.
Yeah.
The National Lottery, what do we reckon? Random or not random?
Got to be random, surely.
Yeah, no, it's totally random. So what's the sensible technique if you're going to play the lottery? Lots of people do.
Buy lots and lots and lots of tickets.
Just buy them all.
Buy them all. Yeah.
Buy them all. No, you need to play the numbers that nobody else does. It doesn't mean you're more likely to win. It just means you're less likely to share the prize. So people tend to play numbers with their birthday in. So anything over 31 is a very good idea. People, weirdly, 7 still regarded as a lucky number, so don't play things with 7 in. Don't play last week's numbers. Apparently, the Germans had the time to do a study and they found 12,000 people who were playing last week's numbers. I mean, I don't mind the Germans particularly. I'm not having a go in any way at the Germans.
Sounds like it.
Don't get me started.
Speaking of insects, what is this fly doing in this painting?
Oh, the one by the plate?
There's also one on her head.
Oh, yes. Talking to the one by the plate.
Yeah.
Come up here. The food's here. The food's down here. You can see for miles up here. They'll swat you. They won't. She won't swat herself in the head, will she?
It's called Musca Depicta. So Musca, Latin for fly. And it was to show how skillful the artist is. It's a way of saying, I can paint a fly that is so realistic an observer might just want to kind of...
Well, clearly not, because that's the world's biggest fly.
So when you see the painting, you think, there's a fly on it.
Yeah, there's a fly, yeah, exactly.
Oh! Oh, my God! painted off.
At the time it was painted, that was thought to be quite a thing, so it was a fairly new idea, the concept of trompe l'oeil, or trick of the eye.
Do people go in and try and eat the beans?
That, exactly that.
It's a painting! Yeah. Oh, my God! Yeah.
The very supposed first ever use of the trompe l'oeil was a painting competition in ancient Greece between the artists Zeuxis and Parrhasius, and Zeuxis painted some realistic grapes that apparently the birds flew down and tried to take, and so Parrhasius then painted a curtain that was so realistic that Zeuxis himself was fooled and tried to push it to one side.
Do you think all of these stories from ancient Greece are just nonsense?
Yes, let's not do that anymore.
It's so exciting to me. Yes, rip it up, rip it up!
Yes!
It's nonsense.
It's
the bird flew
nonsense.
Down to the grapes. It did not. It's 2D. The bird can't identify that. It's not seeing grapes. The curtains, the real curtains. Bullshit! You can tell it's a painting. And the Greeks, they just spread it about. Yeah, that happened. And we, for thousands of years, we're still going, amazing, you know, an ancient Greek, the best thing.
The single...
How have they convinced us of this? Yeah. Utter nonsense.
I don't know. The single torn card. I've got rid of the whole of Greek mythology.
Yes! Get that, move that, Alan.
Yeah.
So that is amazing. That was painted in 1658.
That actually does look like a curtain.
Isn't that incredible?
In fairness, that is good, though, right?
I mean, if the Greeks saw that, they'd shit themselves.
This is a true story, but you sort of can't believe it. So in the 1960s, the Soviets wanted a method to send emergency communications to submerged submarines. When they're underwater, they cannot receive or indeed send radio signals, so they turned to rabbits. This is a genuine experiment. The hypothesis was that the mother-newborn bond existed as a sort of telepathic communication, right? So they took a mother rabbit from her offspring and they put electrodes on her brain and they placed her in a submarine. This is a serious experiment. And then they, on land, killed the baby. I know, it's horrific.
God,
it's horrific.
What did the baby do?
It died.
Just saying, you know, I want to hear both sides of this story.
Yeah. Yeah, the idea is that the mother would be able to sense the baby's distress and that changes to her brain would signal to the submariners to surface and to radio home and receive instructions. That's a genuine experiment.
But did they have to kill it? Could they not have just made it do, like, hard maths or something? And it'd be like, my baby's trying to do maths!
If you've got a claustrophobic rabbit,
yeah,
you'll just keep coming up.
Time to go to the surface! I think they're all right in holes, though, aren't they, rabbits? I don't know much about rabbits, but they don't mind a burrow, do they?
I think they don't mind.
Yeah. I think they're all right with that.
I think that's fair, Rob. You don't get many rabbits at home going, I can't be in here, I can't be in here.
Yeah, it's all enclosed in. It's all dark. It's all dark, little tunnels everywhere. I'm a rabbit, I can't live like this.
Do you believe in telepathy? Do you guys, anybody believe in it?
Yeah.
So researchers at the University of Washington and Carnegie Mellon University in 2018, they demonstrated actual telepathy while playing the game of Tetris. They had two players wearing what's called EEG caps, that's electroencephalography, and they can detect electrical activity produced by their thoughts. And so they watched a game happening and they simply thought about what moves should be played, right? Then there was a third player wearing the transcranial magnetic stimulation cap. And he received the thoughts and then moved the pieces despite not being able to see the screen. And the experimenters reported an 81% accuracy in the moves made. Now, if it could point to a future where there is brain-to-brain interfaces, imagine the possibility of direct communication for people who are deaf or in other ways impaired. It would be incredible.
Yeah, that would be amazing, but I don't want anyone knowing what's going on in here.
Yeah.
The world would fall apart if people knew all the deviant thoughts that...
But that's just Twitter, isn't it?
That's just... That's exactly true.
I can sometimes tell when my husband's about to talk. I don't think that's telepathy, though. It's a little breathing thing, I think. Yeah. I think that's what it is.
You can hear him behind the tape.
Yeah.
What's that under the floorboard, Sarah?
Sometimes he's genuinely decided to not say the thing he was going to say.
Right.
Because it wasn't worth it.
No.
But because I've gone, what were you going to say? He has to say it, and I go, well, why did you say that? And he goes, well, I wasn't going to say it, and you made me say it.
So
that's
you're...
where my marriage is at.
Yeah.
Is it telepathy when you know you need a poo?
It would be telepathy if you knew that Sarah needed a poo.
Yeah. It would depend how far you were from your own arse. So the whole...
I don't need to be at the same distance.
Yeah.
But if you know you'll need a poo later, that's precognition.
So if you could time it, like...
Okay, stop!
That would be like if you just had Weetabix.
Is Weetabix like instant like that?
No, no, it's you know you're gonna have one late and it's gonna be decent.
Holes can you see in this cheese?
Oh my god, I can't.
Right. Oh, don't look, you don't like holes, do you?
Every time.
Every time we have holes on this show.
Every time it's holes.
I'm so sorry. Don't look. But also, you won't get any points for this one.
It's okay because they're not right next to each other, oh. Exactly the same size.
Okay, good.
So, how do you use a sieve?
I don't.
Can we not talk about sieves? Literally every time I'm on the show, they show me holes.
I'm sorry, the world's got a lot of holes in it.
Would you play golf if you never actually looked?
No, it's
that's just one hole. There has to be lots of holes together on the same size.
So a cheese grater would be bad. Connect four.
So why don't you keep listing things that have got loads of holes in them?
What with you, you psycho?
I feel like I've known you a long time. I feel like we're quite close. It's never come up.
Only because you've got no holes in you, Deborah.
If I asked you to play a game of tennis, could you do that? Because a tennis racket...
There's a bit of holes in the net.
They have to be round.
Got to be round, Deborah.
I'm so sorry. I've okay. not been filled in.
No.
I'm not insane. I'm just...
How many holes in this cheese?
Two.
Is correct. So...
getting a clap
because there's
I never get anything right.
He's right, there's only two holes.
But you can see there's only two holes.
Well, nobody else said it.
How many fingers have I got?
I get one thing right.
Give him 100 points.
Yeah. I think they're patronising Alan. Let's give Alan one he can answer, that kind of thing. And then we'll do a bit of colouring in and it's home time.
Story.
We're talking about topology. There are only two holes. The other things you can see are dents and deformations and so on. The only way there could be another hole in the cheese is if there was a hole inside that was fully enclosed that we couldn't see. So there's a branch of mathematics called topology, and it deals with shapes and spaces and holes and so on. So a topologist, and indeed Alan, would only see two holes in this picture. Let's try an easier one. How many holes does this have?
Two.
Two.
It's because one to blow it up. And one in the middle.
You're sort of right, but your reasoning is not right.
It's impeccable.
We can't count the one with the valve in it because it's closed in this picture. So that's not a hole. Okay. Yeah. So you've got the one that the person's body goes through and then another one that makes up the hollow tube going around the outside. But okay. That only counts as a second hole if it's hollow. So, for example, a ring donut is different to a rubber ring because it's filled in with dough and it's not hollow, so a donut only has one hole. Mm. But the rubber ring has two holes because the whole of the hollow space counts as a hole. I happen to have a donut. There are donuts for everybody, and that's the joke of it. So the donut, at no point is it hollow in this part, it's only got one hole, right?
I'll just check that for me.
Yeah, just see how that is.
All right. Yeah.
Yours is
brilliant,
vegan.
Lovely.
That's it.
That's a good way to earn bigger tips if you're waiting tables. But you've been a waiter?
Worked as a caterer.
You worked as a caterer? What were you doing?
Catering.
No, I'd done a job delivering cakes and the recipient of the cakes had moved on from the time that they were being delivered, so I just had a fat full of cake. And I just lived off cake for months.
This is a dream, Bill.
Oh, yeah.
Well, a top tip, apparently, if you want to get a tip, is to wear something unusual.
Oh.
Unusual?
Yeah. So, for example, waitresses with floral hairpins earned 17% more than people with plain hairpins.
Ah.
Yeah.
Would it be like if we were to compliment the diners, or to sort of when they were just coming to the end of an anecdote, as you put the food down, you went, ex- excellent story.
Well, so the whole thing about being funny, wearing a funny button apparently helps. Joke cards work as well. So French researchers supplied waitstaff with jokes for customers, and 42% of those who used them were tipped, compared with 25% of the staff who didn't.
There you go.
The more people will tip you if you give them a little bit of a laugh.
A bit of a laugh. Yeah, see? But I didn't get 2 points for that.
Three points for that.
No, don't.
There's also a thing called postural congruence, which is weird. So if you squat at the table and you get your face closer, apparently that can boost your tips.
What?
Touching customers, but in a, you know.
Wait a minute.
To make you go away.
Let me cut it out for you.
I've got a flat mouth.
Choo-choo! Choo-choo! Open your mouth! Open, here comes the train!
I'm in one of Bill's dreams!
You're going to hit me with a fat bastard.
There's also casual touch manipulation. So basically, if
Don't be unpleasant.
Don't be weird. But like, just very quickly touch somebody on the shoulder pad.
That's proper manipulative.
That's just invading someone's space.
Yeah. And apparently, the best thing to do is while you're putting the bill.
There you go.
Bill, is when you put the check on the table.
That's when you get touchy-touchy.
That's the moment to distract from the amount. You just touch them at that. You're all right.
There you go, sir. Service, is service included? Don't say that.
Is service...
No, it's not.
I'm writing to a lawyer.
Homage to one of the most famous fictional spies, I think we should end with a martini, OK? So, how would anybody like theirs?
Shake it, not stirred, no?
So, the thing is, but shaking a martini will ruin it.
Yeah.
And I know this because I'm a martini fan, yeah. OK? So, drinks like daiquiris, they're shaken, and the reason for that is that the ice dilutes the sweetness. Martinis are not sweet, so they don't need to be shaken. They're supposed to be served as concentrated as possible. Unfortunately, we can't drink the original martinis that James Bond is supposed to have had because one of the key ingredients is no longer available.
Oh.
It's known as a Vespa martini. It was named after the first Bond girl. She was called Vespa Lind. Oh.
Vespa's Italian for wasp. Did you know that?
I didn't know that.
It's the hence the
scooter, the Vespa.
It sounds like a wasp.
Wasp, see?
I didn't know that.
The Vespa martini contained gin and vodka and something called Quina Lillet. Doesn't sound pleasant, does it?
It would absorb a lot. You don't want that in your martini.
Anyway, the trick is to stir it. Have you got drinks there for yourselves?
Yes. Okay.
Just to pour out into tribute here.
Woohoo!
Okay. Jeez. Do you know that Dick Van Dyke was once asked by Cubby Broccoli if he wanted to take over from Sean Connery in the role? And Dick Van Dyke reminded him of his British accent as Bert, the Cockney chimney sweep. Generally, thought not to be a very good idea. Well, here we go.
Here we go. Cheers.
Martinis are better stirred than shaken, and underpants are better silk than shatin. We got these by feeding hundreds of questions taken from the QI database, which is called Blue Whale, into an artificial intelligence program, and we asked the program to come up with new questions in the same style. So this is artificial intelligence QI questions. First of all, what happens if a flamingo is your wife?
People are very judgy about it.
Flamingoist,
exactly. And people talk about animal husbandry a lot, but they don't talk about bird whiffery a lot.
If a flamingo is your wife, probably the best option is to dress up as an egg so you're guaranteed to get laid.
Here's a question for you, Alan. What is the best way to get a radiant complexion of trousering?
Wow. And you need to emerge from within the trousers, Sandi.
I'm not a massive fan of the QI supercomputer.
No.
With these.
No. But the question that it asked over and over again, which I'm extremely keen on, is how many legs does the Queen have?
She has one of her own legs, and then the other one's a sort of official leg.
Official leg.
Yeah.
So it asked over and over again how many legs does the Queen have, and then suddenly announced, I'm naked. And it also answered one of its own questions. How did the Romans, was the question, and the answer was, nobody knows. So there's an American research scientist called Janelle Shange, and she programmed similar sort of neural network to read existing Love Heart slogans. Do you remember Love Hearts, those little sort of sweets? So they're usually fairly tame, but she reprogrammed the AI to do it, and this is what it came up with. Loving horn, buns, 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 and all hail the chicken.
I think they would sell that hotcake.
Next Valentine's Day, all hail the chicken.
Yeah, right.
So she has a point in doing this. It's not just a sort of a bit of silliness. AI still has lots of limitations. So you can't...
Making love hearts. Like,
for example, one of the things that we need to look at is neural networks are prone to something called catastrophic forgetting. So forgetting old information as new data is fed in. And AI also has a problem with giraffing. Anybody know what giraffing might be?
Sticking your neck out. Getting off high shelves.
Yes, no. So it constantly identifies things as giraffes.
Oh, great.
Yeah, or anything unusual. Why might that be?
Because it's stupid.
No, what it is, it's trained online, and online people tend to post unusual things more than they'll post a sort of featureless rock or something. They're much more likely to post a giraffe, for example.
I hate it when people post featureless rocks.
Featureless rocks. It's very irritating.
Put some features on that rock, for God's sake.
AI thinks that giraffes are more common than they are, because people on the whole tend to put up unusual things, and therefore it thinks that they are more usual.
I mean, if you live in, like, Namibia or somewhere, you might see giraffes. I mean, I don't know if giraffes live in Namibia.
Yes.
They do? OK.
Let's say
well,
yes.
Well, then you're going to see a lot...
Go zebra.
OK, you're going to see a lot of them. It's just that when you live in Lewisham, you don't see that many of them.
Right.
The what old Namibia-Lewisham paradox again.
I'd love to see one in Lewisham. More likely to cause a quarrel than a badly ordered queue. So my question is, what's the best way to board a plane? The people are in the lounge and you want to board them onto the plane. What's the most efficient way of doing that?
Minimise hand baggage, all those wankers who can't be bothered to check their bags and come on like mules, like pack mules, fill up all the overhead lockers with their very important shit. And sit down farting all the way to Malaga. Sorry, what was the question?
There's lots of bitterness in this, isn't there?
I had a moment on a flight last week, actually, when I was flying from Aberdeen to Shetland, and I was with my tour manager, who's also a big chap, and we sit next to each other, because we're pals, and there was hardly anyone else on the flight. It was only a small plane. And the stewardess came over, and she said, Mr. Manford, Mr. Isaac, she said, would you mind separating and sitting on either side of the plane?
Weight distribution!
You're as heavy as a wing.
So he's gonna land like this if we...
Well, that's what you should have done. We will at the start.
Yeah.
But during the flight, we're gonna set you a series of challenges. Zigzagging about the plane.
First time in the history of the world where turbulence is a person.
Yeah.
That's how I'm gonna think of you now, as turbulence.
That's me.
By the back row, then the next row, then the next
row. That is
row,
the most like common. That. Yeah, that is the most common way of doing it. It is also the least efficient.
Or in the middle, and then fan it out towards the back and the front.
Take the top off the plane. And have them all swarm in over the top like that.
So there's an astrophysicist called Dr. Jason Steffen. He made a computer model, and then he teamed up with a TV producer to get people to act out boarding planes in various different arrangements. So he compared boarding from the front, from the back, at random, and what he called Wilma boarding, which is window, middle, and then aisle. Nice. Block boarding, by far the slowest. That's the way the airlines currently do it. So they say this group of seats and then the next group of seats. The absolute best way to do it is board first the even-numbered window seats, followed by the odd-numbered window seats, then repeat with the middle seats, and then repeat seat with the aisle seats. It's rather complicated. And so he actually recommends just board at random. That would still be much faster than what we currently do.
You don't want too random, do you? You don't want to be on, like, 16 rows back and the pilot's there.
I was boarding recently and this lady announced, "We are boarding everyone not in zone F." And then she said, "And also not in zone A, B, C, D, E." Then she paused and said, "We're just not boarding."
I think there's two types of passengers. They're the ones who think that if anything happened to the pilot, they could probably be all right if they took over and got talked in.
Yeah, that's me.
And there's the other ones who would think there's no way they could do that.
I sort of fancy myself being able to fly a plane. You're right. I think I could bloody give it a go.
But don't you think that when you've watched a load of ER, for example, that you think,
yeah,
I totally could do that heart surgery?
I sort of feel like I'd be naturally good in emergencies. Like, I can't speak Spanish now, but I feel like if there was an emergency, I probably could give it a go.
Yeah. What kind of emergency suddenly requires Spanish?
I feel like the Spanish girl, Sandy. She's come in, she's choking. No one else in the hospital speaks Spanish.
Right.
Something's wrong with her.
Yeah.
She can mime, but we're not getting it.
No.
They haven't trained like me in the dramatic art of mime.
Of course.
And so she's like, paella, Madrid, Venezuela. And I'm like, don't worry. Penicillin. And then it'll just be like that for...
That poor child is dying and you're the last thing she sees. Now for a sensory demonstration. I'm going to give you a hearing test. OK, let me get out my little keyboard.
Oh.
Here we go. Now, you should have some whiteboards and some pens there.
Yes.
So, I'm going to play you two notes. You have to write down which is higher or lower, OK? So, I'm going to play this note, don't look, and then... this note, higher or lower? Okay, so what's everybody got?
Higher.
Higher?
Yeah.
Higher?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes, it's correct. It's absolutely right.
Oh, God. Good, okay.
Okay, fine. So now we're going to play you some stuff that has been created by a computer, and I'm going to play you three sets, and I want you to write down on each occasion whether the second note is higher or lower. Okay, really simple.
Yeah,
really simple. Did the note go up or did the note go down?
Yes.
Here we go. Up or down?
But we only get one go.
Yeah. Okay, next one. Up or down?
Well, that's very tricky, isn't it?
Yes. I feel like there's more than one note sneaking in there each time. Mm-hmm.
And the third one. Oh, Rashid's very confident with that one. Okay.
Wrong.
Turn all the boards round. Let's have a quick look. So you have got lower, lower, higher. You have basically got lower, higher, higher. Lower, higher, lower. Higher, up. Lower, higher. I mean, they're all different.
Is this gold dress, blue dress, but for the ears?
It is an auditory illusion.
I'd just like to point out that I haven't drawn a cock and balls.
Well done.
Do you want to do it now? Would you feel better?
I think, you know, in terms of children, you'd say this was a developmental milestone.
I'd say that this is a sign of maturity. So, the truth is that what you were listening to, the tones go both up and down. It is called the tritone paradox. So there's two notes effectively being played. It's like C and F sharp at the same time.
Ah.
And then the next note is one in the middle. And the consequence of that is it's both higher and lower, depending
on
which note seemed more prominent. So you are all correct. It doesn't really matter which you put, whether you put up or down, or higher or lower. Shall we hear it again? Let's see if you can hear it now.
Huh. I don't like it. So that's your doorbell. Oh, you'd never answer
it. It's very annoying, isn't it? It's just an illusion, so that it sounds as if... frankly, it could go up and down. But what's most interesting about it was analysed by a music psychologist called Diana Deutsch in 1986. And what she realised is what we hear, whether we hear it going up or whether we hear it going down, very much depends on our culture, on our language.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, the perception is probably going to be the same as your parents. It's probably going to be the same as sort of people in the area that you live. People who have a very much more musical language will hear it differently from people who are rather sort of straightforward with their language. I think it's fascinating. It'll tell you something about people just whether they say it's higher or lower.
Wow. That's fascinating, even in terms of what makes the sound of a joke, how you play it, the sound of your voice in different cultures. Can you hear a joke happening if you don't understand the language and the rhythm of something and what cadence works in different cultures? Yeah.
I'd love someone to tell my mum that. I've got a mum who's really desperate to have somebody in our family who's really good at any kind of instrument or anything. So now I can tell her I am, because I do comedy.
Are you musical, Alan? Not in the slightest.
He's drawn a lovely dick and balls, though. So he is still artistic.
Describe the dark side of puppeteering.
Well, surely it's everything that goes on...
Yeah.
..underneath.
Below the
desk. That's the way to do it!
Oh, dread to think.
Alan, stop playing with your puppet under the table.
My hands are firm. What do all the other puppets do when you put them down?
Specific kind of puppetry that we're thinking of, the dark side of puppetry. Any thoughts?
Shadows?
What about Hank Marvin? Would you or wouldn't you?
I tell you what, Cliff Richard, I definitely would. Don't say anything. I would.
Talking about a specific type of shadow puppetry, I've got some examples here. So it's Java, Indonesia, Southeast Asia. It's a 1,000-year-old form of a shadow puppet theatre called a wayang. So they often tell Hindu epics. The only thing is, the shows can last 8 or more hours, right?
Of course they can. I mean, if it's in a Bollywood film, they last 16 days.
Yes, exactly that.
I mean, all puppet shows feel like they've lasted 8 or 9 hours.
In the ninth hour of the Punch of Judy.
Unfortunately, it is a skill which is very slightly dying out. So some of the puppeteers have taken to performing Star Wars-themed shows, for example, to younger audiences, and they take some liberties. So there we've got Chewbacca and Han Solo.
I am all for that.
You think that's okay?
Love it. Still have my original Star Wars toys. I have a whole section of the garage devoted to Star Wars memorabilia. I even have my Star Wars pajama, you know, pants. And I go to... Don't laugh at me! I go to bed dressed.
Where else is he going to keep his lightsaber at night?
I mean, well, I've got nothing.
Yeah. Whoa, but yeah, whoa. Massive Star Wars fan. I love that. I think that's a great idea.
You only have the trousers.
No, I have the top bit too, but it's like I have one that's Darth Vader pants, and then on the top it says, "I'm your daddy."
It's just so wrong.
I've never watched Star Wars.
Did you want to confess anything while we're doing this? Like turning it into therapy?
Well, yeah, maybe. I don't know.
I think that seeing Star Wars is a confession in itself.
That is quite a big. Alan, did you have anything you wanted to reveal to the rest of the world?
Oh,
actually,
man.
I asked you this once and you told me you'd pooed on Hampstead Heath or something.
Oh, yes. That's right, and I'm not falling into this trap again.
Lovely. Anyway, they're now using Wayang shows, which is what this puppetry is, to explain all sorts of things. They've used it for COVID-19. They use it for the destruction of coral reefs. I mean, all sorts of kind of educational stuff. It's quite complex, and traditionally there's just one puppet master who's called a dalang, and they are highly respected, and it used to be that Indonesian children wanted to grow up and be a dalang. Usually boys would work the puppets and girls play the genda, which is a bit like a glockenspiel. And the puppets, as you can see, are really intricate. And perversely, considering they're there to create shadows, they're very brightly painted.
Yeah, that is odd, isn't it?
Yes, this is just a curiosity. I've got ready.
This is a move. Yas, queen! Yas, queen! Yas! Yas, queen! Yas, yas, yas! Yas, queen!
What's that thing called, darling? Is it called a GIF or whatever it is, where you... TikTok thing.
You cluck.
And, yeah. Could I say something and then you just stand behind me going, "Yas, queen!
Yas, queen!"
I love that.
I'll do a soundbite for you. You can use it.
Yes, please. I'd like that very much.
I really enjoyed the talk about social media there. That was cute. That was
cute. I genuinely have no idea what I just...
Can I do a GIF on TikTok? No, you can't, but yes.